of God is great. And we're going to learn something today about the gospel. You know, the gospel is the good news. Right. Just going to share the good news this morning. Thanks for being here. And don't forget to invite a friend. All right? Always invite a friend so we can see this place grow. Thank you. God bless you.
All you guys, you're just going to have to bear with me today because I'm probably going to cry a lot today. Can't help it. It's all good, okay? It's just so good that I just can't quit. So, and it's already been good this morning, even right here. So I hope that's something that you guys will feel, that you'll know is a part of this experience that we have together as a church family coming to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And it's just so good. It's so good. And I have just lately, I'll say in the last days, maybe just a few days, I just realized over and over again how good it is and how good He is to us all, but to me, you know, it's a selfish thing in a way, but it's just so evident to me, and I hope it is for you too, and I hope that you won't go away from here today without taking a whole bunch of that home with you and then spread it out everywhere you go. I hope there's people in Santa Rosa, California that I've spoken to this week, others here in town, in other cities that might be watching our service today. And I want to pray for our service today and pray for all those that are viewing us, all those that hear us, and even those that don't, that are in this community, that we need our Father to minister to these people everywhere we go. And so those people are in need, and we need to pray for those, okay? You guys, don't forget, prayer is the main thing. So let's pray this morning. Father, You are so good. And we just are so thankful that we know how good You are. And Father, for all of those that are out there that in this old world, Father, that are troubled, that are confused, that have problems, that have issues in their lives, that's all of us, Father. But I just ask for Your special attention to those today. Don't let depression in the lives of Your children, Father. Show us and show everyone the joy of the love of Your Son, Jesus Christ. And today, all we need is just Your Holy Spirit to work in our midst today, Father, so that we might experience that love and that joy, give it out to one another and out to everyone that we meet. And so, Father, we just say thank You in Your Son's name. And everyone said, amen.
Let's stand together. Well, we're going to sing a song that speaks of our willingness and joy to worship the Lord our God. He is a source of our joy, strength, power, peace, blessing, favor, goodness, everything that's special, heavenly, divine, comes from Him. And because of that, we know the source. 10,000 years, upon 10,000 years, upon 10,000 years, that's how long we're going to keep on praising the Lord, just out of grateful hearts to the Lord. So join us. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, the sun comes up,
It's a new day dawning, and it's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never.
Do that for a few moments. Just worship the name of Jesus. Lord, we worship your name. Hallowed be thy name. Name above all names. We come in the mighty name of Jesus. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Who run into it, Lord. Jesus, how blessed is your name. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Forever and ever, Lord, we will praise the name. Sing the name of Jesus. El Shaddai, Jehovah Sitkanu, my righteousness, my redeemer. Lord,
to sing the name of my Lord. He saved my soul, set my feet upon a rock.
Thank you, Jesus. In advance, thank you, Jesus.
The giver of life.
Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you that according to your word, Jesus has been given a name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, when that name is proclaimed, everything, everyone, everything that has lived as a human being, every angel that has been created, every fallen angel, everything will bow their knee and will worship. And we'll acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we, Lord, today, with freely, with our will and our minds intact, we freely give glory and honor to that name. And we bend our knee to you and to you alone. Be magnified, be glorified, Lord, in Jesus' name, as we continue to celebrate and worship and praise your name. Put your hands together. Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I seek, the only name that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me, the only name that matters to me. Yours is the name. Yours is the name that has saved me, your mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. Say that again. Yours is the name. Yours is the name that has saved me, your mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. From the top, yours will be. Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I seek, the only name that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me, the only name that matters to me. And yours is the name. Yours is the name that has saved me, your mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. Oh, say that again. Yours is the name that has saved me, your mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. Here's what's going to happen when I wake up.
I wake up in the land of glory with the saints. I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. Yeah, when I wake up in the land of glory with the saints, I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim.
All right, let me hear you sing out that name. Jesus.
Just that name.
When I wake up with a mighty voice.
me hear you sing that name again. Jesus. Praise offering for his goodness. Hallelujah, Lord. Let's sing of his grace. Declare, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. He's worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. And I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Let's applaud our God for all that he's done for us. Woo! Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
driving here this morning, I was just thinking about, you know, it's been a rough week, and so I was just thinking about all the things that I did this week and how I was like sweating on the top of my roof, messing with my air conditioner for 3 days. And I was like, Lord, you know, I was drenched in sweat. I mean, and I'm a bigger guy now. I graduated from the little man's club to the big man's club, and I just found out what it's all about. It's like I am pouring sweat. It's just like, and I was just thinking about those things, the other things, you know, that were like other things I had to take care of. I was just thinking, wow, Lord, I just don't feel like I'm into it, you know, I was just feeling. And then God just said, just remember my faithfulness. Remember the times that I met you right where you're at. You didn't deserve any of it. I was thinking, oh, Lord, yeah. I had those pictures. There were events. I was like, wow, you met me, Jesus. You scooped me up. You picked me up. Not because of how good I was, but how good you were. And the grace of God started ministering to me. I started reminding myself. It's just the enemy trying to, you know, sort of bog us down. But we have so much in the Lord. We have so much blessings in our lives. I'm sweating now. But God is so good. You know, I know, even in our little community here, we've experienced some rough times. We've experienced some loss of life, right? We know we have family members that are going through struggles. And, I mean, our society is going through tumultuous times. There's no solid footing right now. And so sometimes when we can get bogged down, but let me just tell you, brothers and sisters, God loves you. He is smiling his face upon you. His grace is upon you. And bypass your feelings, your emotions. Really, bypass it. I know for some of us it's really hard because everything, our outlook is really chained to our feelings. But bypass that. Out of faith, worship the Lord. Out of faith, thank him. He's been good to us. You're here this morning. What a beautiful place to be. We could have been anywhere. But God gave you the grace and the want to, even if it was just a little bit, to come here. And the presence of the Lord is here. Our King Jesus is here. So just close your eyes for a few moments. Forget about me. Forget about this building. Look at Jesus. He's on the cross. He is suffering. And his face, it's not in agony. There's a smile on his face because he knows he's dying for you. And he's going to change your life. For the joy set up for him, he was willing to go to be obedience to the Father, even death on the cross, to be a curse for us. He did it. For the joy that was set before him. He made his face like flint, like immovable, because he knew beyond all that feeling, you and me were going to be here this morning worshiping the Lord in spite of how we feel, in spite of maybe confusion or bewilderment, but we're worshiping the Lord. Hallelujah. We welcome you, Jesus. We welcome you, Lord. Our eyes are on you, Jesus.
Yes.
The royal King, come into our lives and establish here your throne, your kingdom. So we can declare, Lord, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Hallelujah. Lord, we open the gate here at Open Gate, and we want to let the King of Glory in. Come, Lord, reign, O God, reign in this place, O Lord. We bow before you, God. Hallelujah. Worthy, O God.
See, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of love, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. The glory to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Oh Lord, your presence, Lord.
Holy Spirit. Become more aware of your presence, and let us experience the glory of your good.
This is our cry, our prayer.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your good.
Sing it out.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Oh, let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit.
come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence. We thank you for your grace, and you command your presence here in our midst, oh God. It's so glorious, so powerful, and we just pray that this throughout this morning that you would be in control of everything that is said and done, that all the glory and honor would go to you, Lord, because you've been so good to us, and that I pray you would continue to transform our lives, Lord, in your presence. Lord, begin to even set free those who have never understood the freedom and the liberty that you want to give to your people, Lord. And I just pray, God, that they would experience that. They would be able to say, I've tasted and seen. They could say they've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where their heart has become free, so they can enjoy all that you have because of your presence in their lives, Lord. Let it be done now, in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. Let's get out of our seats for a few moments, and let's just introduce yourself to a few folks, greet some folks. Let's try to be a little careful, make sure we don't jeopardize anybody. You can go ahead and play a song there if you want.
told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough.
All right, well, let's find our places, everyone. We're going to show a video. But again, we just like to say welcome to Open Gate Church. We're so glad that you arrived. How you are lending your heart to this ministry. There are even folks that are connected to Open Gate. Did you know this? Through our Facebook page, people are having a step foot here, but they support us, they pray for us, they know some of your stories. Isn't that weird? That's a little weird, huh? Like, they know all about me. I never even seen them before. But that is the world that we live in. There are people on the East Coast, there are people in Central U.S., Midwest, that are watching us, that are a part of Open Gate Church. So there are people internationally, people that, friends of ours that we've ministered throughout the world, and they hear about us, and they look online, and they are hanging out with us. So isn't that neat to be a part of? Here we are in this humble place, this humble part of town, and yet we are able to share this beautiful, gracious gospel message with each other, the love of God, and around the world. We're living in amazing times. This is awesome. So we got a video we want to show you.
Multitasking. All right. So, my name's Scott. I'm a believer in Jesus, and I struggle with anger and codependency, alcohol and drugs. And I just wanted to come up and talk about Celebrate Recovery. And so in Celebrate Recovery, that's how we introduce ourselves, as we don't identify with our issues or our struggles. We identify that we're a believer in Jesus who has issues that Jesus helped us with. And so, a little video that's, you know, there's some things that we go through life, kind of feels like you're climbing mountains, that you're struggling, and it's hard to get through. And so with Celebrate Recovery, it gives us a toolbox that we can use to build a relationship with Jesus so that we can start building our life and start working on some of our issues, some things that maybe we've pushed down inside. And so Monday nights, 5:30, we have dinner. 6 o'clock, we have our large group with worship. Then we break into small groups, men with men, women with women, and we kind of just work together. So if you guys like to, anybody like to come, or if you have anybody that would like to be here, again, Monday nights, 5:30, we have dinner, and 6 o'clock, our large group. So, and then Alice has some other announcements.
Thank you, Scott. Sorry, I was out of breath here. trying to write some stuff down. Isn't the Lord good? He's amazing. I was sharing with a couple right now about our busy week and how it was. Well, actually, Anthony's busy week. But I was telling him, when it rains, it pours. And there's a lot of stuff going on at our home and things like that. And I was telling him, our son had invited us to go eat dinner. We're like, yeah. So we get all ready and ready to go. We drive up the gas station, and the car doesn't want to start. So we're like, oh, Lord. But thank God it was just the battery. So thank you, Lord. I tend to exaggerate and say, oh, no, I need a new car. Anthony goes, calm down. It's just, we got to check it out. Let's call JR, who's our mechanic here. So I was like, I need a new vehicle. This is it. So I only had the car for 3 years. So, and so he laughs at me all the time because he's like, you exaggerate the whole situation, Alice. I'm like, I know. Sorry. So anyway, but the Lord has reminded me that we could come and rest in his peace. And where do we find that? Through prayer, through attending church with our brothers and sisters who encourage us and lift us up and love us, and just seeing you guys lifts our spirit, because it's just a nice refreshing spirit compared to your messed up week. It's all dried and it's dark and it's, you know, just going through all that, and then you come to church and you just find the peace of God here, and just coming in and just feeling the presence of the Lord was so beautiful this morning. So a few announcements. On Thursday, we're going to have cleaning day at 5:30. We want to clean up the church because we are going to have another ceremony service for our Sister Francis's brother, Pete. It's a funeral service. So we want to clean up the church and have it nice and clean and smelling good and, you know, ready for them that Friday morning. So if you could come out Thursday evening at 5:30. And come support us and just come over and pray for the chairs and pray for the toilets and pray for the floors. And so also Friday night youth is canceled this Friday, but October 30th is when they're going to resume it at 1 p.m. at Sister April's house, okay? So mark your calendars or get together with, and it's on a Saturday. So you can contact Miss April or Miss Jeannie on that for more details, okay? And then also that Friday night, if you could come and just kind of, we're going to come back and clean up the church for another church that meets here on Saturday morning. So if you guys can come out and just support us in that. I'm sure we cleaned it Thursday night, but Friday after everything in the morning, we want to make sure that everything's back together and everything's cleaned up for the next service for the other church, okay? So if you could come out and meet us then about maybe 6 in the evening, Friday, just to make sure everything is okay. Oh, okay, in the afternoon, 3 or 4, if you can come by just to check things out and see if everything's cleaned up. Contact Anthony so for more details on that, okay? And then we're also looking for more signups for the children's ministry for October. So if you could come help us in that area. We don't have many kids, but when they do come, we want to be ready for them, okay? You can see Miss Priscilla to sign up, or you can see myself to sign up for that as well. Also, we are planning a women's meeting on a Saturday morning. But we're going to get back to you guys on more details, because we want to start planning for October 31st is coming up. And we want to know how we can service the community. I talked to a few women already about it, and they gave us some ideas and plans. But we want to have a plan A and a plan B because of the COVID, and we don't know how bad it's going to get, or they're going to shut us down or anything like that. So we want to just get everybody's input and have a plan A and a plan B so we could be ready for the children in the community to serve them. We haven't been able to even go out to the community because of all this COVID, and things are getting worse and things like that. So I think October 31st would be a nice time to get the community out here and get to know us as a church, okay? So listen for more details for Miss Priscilla or myself, and we'll plan, we'll keep you guys updated on that, okay? Thank you.
All right. Well, today, this morning, what we're going to do is we're going to list read Galatians chapter 1. I want us to read the whole scripture, the whole chapter, so that way we can have that sort of in our digestive system. And then after that, we'll talk a little bit about a few things that are mentioned in that chapter. We'll spend a little bit more time next week on this chapter as well. But there's a few things I want to consider that are repeated in this chapter, and then we're going to go over those things. But the Word of God is so special, even just listening to God's Word is really good. Unfortunately, it's the sad thing is because of time and style and culture, people, churches, groups, listening to a whole chapter of the gospel, of a book, it's hard. People lose, we live in an era, in a time when reading is not a high priority anymore. Do you guys know that? People don't read, which I don't get it. The Christian faith is a faith of a text. It's a faith that understands God's word. It's so important that Jesus, the Word, that's one of his titles. He's the Word. And when we love Jesus, we love the Word. When we love the Word, we love Jesus. When you spend, you're going to find yourself throughout the years, if you look past in your past, that the times that you were the strongest in your faith were the times that you probably read or heard the Word of God the most. And the times that you were the weakest were the times that you were the farthest away from God's Word. You will find that. So you want to be strong? Read the Word. And it's not a matter of quantity. Sometimes that I've, you know, there's people that read the Word through the Bible, the whole Bible in a year, and then I'll ask them. I'm a person that, even in learning in school, we have this gift of our minds, but we don't really put it into action. And so people read, consume books, then you ask them about it later. The reading comprehension, it's not there. They can't relocate the information that they read, but they put it on their checklist, I read that book. So in other words, they read to feel good about themselves. They don't read to get the information out of the words. This is sort of one of the problems even reading the Bible. A lot of people get off track when they don't understand how qualitative the Word of God is. I put all over my phone, but the text that I have tons of books in here, and I'm always reading. And I've been even told by quite a few of my pastor friends and different guys. He says, "Man, Anthony, you tell me about a lot of books you've read." And it's like, I haven't heard of none of these books. You know, they're old books and all these authors, old authors and stuff. And I'm like, yeah, because we gotta know. We gotta read. We have to read. And so, but it takes concentration, doesn't it? Now, I'm a musician, and sometimes when you think of musicians, what kind of character their personality do you think they have when you think about a musician? Like an artist, you know, they're all over the place, huh? They're scatterbrains. But let me tell you something, okay? You ask any musician, you ask any artist, we spend hours and hours on our craft. We don't do it when everybody else knows either. Most of the time it's like, you know, when nobody's around, that's when we get, now I can get into what I want to do while nobody's around bugging me, getting me off track. It's true. On the piano, we can spend hours on the piano learning songs and progressions. And me and my son, I taught him how to play the piano. He did something that I did. He got into trouble one summer, and so I did to him what my parents did to me, locked him up in his room for a couple months.
I took everything out of his room. So you might think, it's so abusive. I knew he was going to thank me later, though. I knew it. But anyway, I took everything out. I got his clothes because he was like into hip-hop stuff. You know, he was really looked really nice. You know, he was with the times at school, you know. And I was like, that's gone, boy. Let's go to Goodwill. We're going to get you some really good clothes. You're not styling now, buddy. So he got in trouble. He got grounded. And there is, but the only thing I left in his room was a piano, a keyboard. And it's the kind of keyboard that I learned how to play on. You could program music, drums, and all this stuff. And he sort of suffered for maybe a few days in there. And then I said, hey, I'll show you how to use this if you want. I mean, you're going to be in here anyway. You might as well do something. No! A few days later, I'll show you how to do it. You want me to show you? No! Finally, he said, okay, how does it work? Okay, you can put a drum beat here. Very simple. I just showed him a couple things, and I was gone. A few months later, he's programming. He says, I want to buy another piano, another keyboard. I didn't think it was going to cost me money, you getting into trouble. You master this one first. So he started making all this music, this intricate stuff. It was amazing. You know, I'd ask, hey, where's Adam at? He's in his room. He's not in trouble anymore. I know, but he's in there playing. So as a musician, you know this as a craftsman of other sorts, we can focus. This is an ADHD person is telling you we can focus. God is able to break through all of our nonsense, things that people have told us, you can't do this, you can't read well or whatever. It doesn't matter. God will help us. The grace of God will help us to have focus. Maybe you can even just listen to the Word of God. On YouTube, you can say, you can look for Galatians chapter 1, and you can just put it on a loop and just listen to it over and over. I would actually recommend that you do that. So you listen to it over and over. You sleep with it over and over. You know, it's awesome. My son, my oldest son, he said, Dad, I want to read the Bible. I want to start in Genesis. So now he's got his earbuds. And so all day long, he's working. He's listening to the Word of God. He calls me later on in the evening and says, Dad, wow. Abraham, Jacob, and all Isaac, they were all horrible guys, huh? Horrible. They did some horrible things with their wives. They didn't want to say, this is my wife. They said, this is my sister. And they started doing, yeah, son. But the grace of God is able. So we're having all these discussions because he's getting renewing his mind. He knew these. He grew up listening to these stories, but we forget. I forget. So I encourage you, listen to the Word of God. Read the Word of God. And if it's hard, just put it on over and over and over again. You might think, this is like a teacher or like a teacher telling us what to do. And I don't really like that. I have an automatic mode that I go into when somebody tells me that as a teacher what to do. Rebellion. But what I want to say is this is different, okay? Because our very life, our spiritual life depends on the Word of God and its saturation in our lives. It is a well. And if the well is shallow, when the time comes that you need to take a drink, you're going to be thirsty. So you need to have that well ready, and when the time comes, you will be able to draw. And you know what? You need to do it for your brother and sister. There's going to be times you don't even know. Why did I read this? Why am I focused on this? Then you meet somebody and they're talking to you, they got some problems, and all of a sudden, boom, you have all these scriptures coming out of you. You had no idea. This is our goal. This is our calling. We are ministers. We minister to people around us, and we have to have it in us. So you guys ready? Let's read the Word of God, Galatians chapter 1. First, this is a pattern for you. Before you even read the Word of God, you have to pray. If you try to do something without prayer, you know what you're saying? I can do it on my own. But God, especially with His Word, He likes to hide things. is. He doesn't want everybody. He wants to, because the Word of God is the Spirit. It is inspired. And only by faith can we understand God's Word. So we need to ask God for His help. So pray with me. Lord Jesus, I pray that You give us the ability to understand Your Word with our minds. And then we would have the focus, the attention to take it in. We are without that, Lord. We need You, Your grace, to bless us with that. And we need also the ability to digest it, for it to have an effect. And help us to understand it the correct way. Help us to not be off track. So, Lord, I pray You help us with this through the power of Your Holy Spirit. We thank You in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's read it together. You can just listen. I'll read it. You ready? Paul, an apostle sent not from men nor by a man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised Him from the dead. Verse 2. And all the brothers and sisters with me to the churches in Galatia. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us, for our sins, to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you to live in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let them be under God's curse. As we have already said, so now I'm going to say it again. If anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let them be under God's curse. Am I now trying to win the approval of a human being, of human beings, or of God? Or am I trying to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people, and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by His grace, was pleased to reveal His Son in me so that I might preach Him among the Gentiles, my immediate response was not to consult any human being. I did not go to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was, but I went into Arabia. Later, I returned to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Cephas, or Peter, and stayed with him 15 days. I saw none of the other apostles, only James, the Lord's brother. I assure you before God that what I am writing to you is no lie. Then I went to Syria and Cilicia. I was personally unknown to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only heard the report, the man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy. And they praise God because of me. There it is. One chapter. We just just listen to a chapter of the Bible. Isn't that awesome? Go back in your Bible, if you have a Bible, or maybe you can highlight in your scriptures, highlight the word gospel, and highlight the word like it and this. You can highlight because it's referring back to the gospel. But the word that we're going to talk about today is the gospel. And quick memory quiz, what does the gospel mean? Mike said it earlier. Good news, that's right. Go spell the good news. It's good news. So, this gospel is what we're going to talk about. He talks a lot about the gospel, the word, the gospel, the gospel, the gospel, the gospel, the gospel, the gospel, the gospel. It's important. If it's important, he's saying there's a gospel. It's powerful. It's amazing that he preached. He got it from Jesus, just like the other apostles. The other apostles got the gospel from Jesus. And so did the apostle Paul, although he got it later, right? Because Jesus appeared to him on his way to Damascus. But Jesus appeared to the other disciples after his resurrection, a lot closer, before the book of Acts. In the middle of the book of Acts is when the apostle Paul meets Jesus, and Jesus tells him the gospel. Okay? And so now we're going to do a review of what the gospel is. And this is important because the way you understand a counterfeit gospel is by not by finding out all the other gospels that are out there. It's by knowing what the true gospel is. It's just like people who can find out, who know right away when there's a counterfeit dollar bill or counterfeit bills. You know how they know? They can tell just by the feel. You know why? They felt the true bona fide bills. As they're counting money, as they're working at a bank, they know, and they just know right away, like, oh, hey, this doesn't feel right. This doesn't feel right. They know right away. So in the same sense, we have to know the gospel. What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? What is this message? Now, the reason why we got to know this is because there was a huge transition in the church, a huge transition. It was formerly tradition. Follow the traditions handed down. Before you knew it, man handed down a distorted culture, a distorted religious practice, and before you know, they were way off in left field. The status quo, let me just tell you, the status quo, that's what you end up with. So every once in a while, throughout even the Old Testament, the New Testament, we need a thing that people call now today is Reformation. We need or revival. We need to get back to taking our car in and getting a tune-up. We got to get things back on track. And so this is what was going on as Jesus came in. Jesus came in. He was the main focus of the nation of Israel. He finally comes, and everybody had no idea that Jesus was a king. And so they rejected him because they wanted the tradition of man. We have to get rid of those things that might beset us or might sidetrack us. And the way we're going to do this is by focusing on what Jesus was all about. You ready? Let's read 1 Corinthians. You got that, Jim? There we go. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1. We're going to read verses 1 through 4. And you should highlight this as well, because as you go back, you want to review this. This is the gospel in a nutshell. This is what the gospel that was given to Paul the Apostle. He's telling it. And so a lot of times when people refer to the gospel, this is the verse that they go to. The gospel, this 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 through 4. You ready? All right. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you. There it is there. You can underline that. He's going to give a definition of what it is. He's going to give a description of what it is, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. He's reminding them, this is the something that has changed your life. You received this gospel, and it had an impact on your life. Here's what they received. Next verse. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preach to you, otherwise you have believed in vain. So he's saying you got to believe. This is this, and there's a tendency to sometimes let it go, to get off track. This is the nature of our human nature, and we also have the ability to believe and trust in this gospel. Next verse, verse 3. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance. Here we go. This is number one, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. We need to underline that. If you have a Bible, you have something you got to listen to, he's going to put some bullet points here. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Okay? Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. That means that he fulfilled the Old Testament plan written down in the scriptures. This is 1 Corinthians, a letter he wrote, but they didn't have the Bible in Corinthians, in the Corinth church. All they had were this letter. The Bible hadn't been put together. So what scripture is he referring to? The Old Testament. They had those written in scrolls. It was written in Greek. They had it translated in Greek from Hebrew. And so they had these scrolls. So he's referring to the Old Testament. This is proof that Jesus is able to die for our sins. The second thing is you see in there is, hey, you have sins. Did you know that? We're sinners. A lot of people they can't admit that they're a sinner. Just ask a 3 or 4 year old. Hi, honey, come on here. Let me, you know, that. Come on in. Let's tell me the sins that you have committed. I have done nothing wrong. The immature child, they don't know what, you know. And many of us are like that the same way. Like we're in an argument. You know, so I'm waiting. What are you waiting for? Aren't you going to apologize? No, me apologize? You need to apologize. I haven't done nothing. In our world, even in us, in our immaturity, whatever it might be, we have to remind ourselves. The scripture reminds us that we have sins in our lives. But Christ died for our sins. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I didn't have to die. I don't have to suffer being separated from God. Jesus did all of that for me. All right, next verse, verse 4. You have to believe that he was buried. You hear that? Why do you have to believe he was buried? Because around that time, a lot of the Jewish people, the traditionalists, the ones who wanted to maintain the status quo, they said, no, he wasn't buried. He didn't die. They were trying to remove this idea and have alternate ideas about Jesus. Even to this day, there are theologians and Bible scholars and all this. They're still trying to say, no, he wasn't dead. He wasn't he wasn't buried. They're trying to take all this away. And they're doing questions like, well, do you really have to believe that Jesus died or that he was buried to be saved? Yes, it's the gospel. You got to believe that. No, you could still, you could still be a Christian. And no, I'm sorry. Sorry, that's not the key. You got the wrong key. The door is here to eternal life. The gospel is the key. You can use whatever key you want, but you're never going to get in. This is the key. You have to believe that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. You see that? All these things are according to God's word. You got to understand this because God's word is powerful. It will be done. When God speaks a promise over you, when God speaks to you through the scripture and you're doubting it, he's saying, don't doubt it. It's going to be done. You got to believe it. You got to trust in it. Your life may try to tell you something else. Don't believe God's word. Don't believe your own words. Don't believe your own self-talk. That's one of the psychological words that people use when they're trying to help people, you know, counsel people. It's called self-talk, the inner talk that's going on inside of us. Even athletes go through all this whole thing, you know, tennis players that are champions and all these GOATs, greatest of all time athletes. They talk about this self-talk. When they make a mistake, they say they're able to let it go and not beat themselves up the whole time. Like me, if I make a mistake, oh, Anthony should have known better. No, these people are able to move on, and this is what we need to do. We need to listen to God's word. It is powerful because it is the Bible, and the gospel is according to the scriptures. It's a fulfillment of God's word. Next. Is that it? Okay. All right. So those are the scriptures. Let's go back to verse 3 again. In a nutshell, the gospel is three things. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Next one. Verse 4. That he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Those three things. That he was buried, raised on the third day. All right. So let's go to the first slide of these are the three things I want to focus on about the gospel. Three reasons why the gospel in this place, in this case, the people were giving a false gospel, or he called it, the Apostle Paul called it a perverted gospel or a distorted gospel. So we're going to go over the three reasons why these people were perverting the gospel or giving a perverted gospel or a distorted gospel. And let me just tell you, it's not just their fault. It's not just people that are promoting these false gospels. We have some responsibility as well. Let me just share with you a little example. You know, there was a gal, there's a person I was talking to, and she was upset at her pastor, at her teacher, because they were going through a series of giving and talking about the generosity of God, how God gives. And how when he puts his spirit inside of us, we have a spirit of generosity. And so it's easy for us. It's one of the things that we learn how to do as Christians. We give. We're generous. So we're not running from these opportunities. We're actually looking for these opportunities to give in different ways, to minister of our talents. We give of our finances. We give of our time. We give whatever we can. God has blessed us with these things. So she goes through this whole, she had been a Christian. She said, she told me, I've been a Christian for 20 years. I go to this place, I get this teaching, and I'm like, I'm mad, she tells me. I'm mad at my pastors back in the U.S. because they never taught me about this. They never taught me about the giving and the generosity of God. All that. So all these years, I really never participated in this kind of stuff. But let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. It is not the responsibility of that teacher to make you do the gospel. We have the Bible. We have the gospel. We can read ourselves. Now, will that person bear responsibility to a certain extent? Yeah, he will. She will. Whoever is. I mean, they didn't give it all. Give all the counsel of the Lord. But ultimately, we are responsible for our walk. You hear me? We're responsible for our walk. The gift that God has given to you, that's your gift. And when you stand before Jesus, your pastor's not going to be there. I'm here, Jesus. I want you to let me in because if I messed up, it was his fault or it was her fault or whatever. No. You can't say, I know, Jesus, I'm in bad shape because of my spouse. You can't put it out, or it's because of my parents, or it's because of my kids, it's because of my dog, it's because of my neighbor, it's because of my sister. You don't know how she is. You're going to be there all by yourself, and you're responsible. We are responsible for the gift that God has given to us. So, yes, a teacher is going to be held responsible, but we will bear responsibility for our walk as well. So let's have a strong walk. Let's make sure that we know what the gospel truly is, and then we can talk a little bit about this distorted gospel that's out there. Number one, the gospel is offensive to our pride. The gospel offends our pride. It tells us we need a savior and that we cannot save ourselves. It gives no credit to us at all for our salvation. It is all the work of Jesus for us. That's a hard pill for some people to swallow. Some religions are built on, you want to be saved? You want to get into heaven? Yes, I do. I want you to as well. And here's what you got to do. You got to do this. Okay, I can do that. You got to do this. Okay, I can do that. Okay, and then you got to do this. Okay, I can do that. And when you do all those three, you can pat yourself on the back. You can pick up your chest. You can pick up your head and say, I did all those. Look at me, I'm Sandra D. I did it my way. I'm in heaven. Why should Jesus is there? Why should I let you in heaven? Because I did those three things that they told me to do. No. We trust and rest our faith in what Jesus did. And I'm just going to say, I'm unworthy. It's because of what Jesus did. He told me all I had to do is trust and believe and receive his gift that he won on Calvary for me. And I did. And that's all I'm here. That's the only reason why I'm here, Lord. That's the best reason, son. Come on in. And you know you can come on in because I've also blessed you even before you came on in. When you were living your life, I blessed you in that way too. I gave you foretaste. I gave you benefits and blessings before. Little tastes of heaven in proof that you were my son. You were my daughter. So, the gospel, the true gospel, offends our pride. This is something that really goes on in churches, people's lives, people that come from different backgrounds. Because here's the thing, when we see each other and we're feeling bad about ourselves, you know what we got to do? We have to, our pride tells us we got to look at the bad in others so we can feel better about ourselves. And so, a lot of times, that's why we are on the straight and narrow. You know people that are on the straight and narrow path? They don't do anything, all these things, right? They stay on the straight and narrow. They do good. They're upstanding citizens. And they're doing awesome. They are really a blessing to our community. But it's offensive. The gospel is offensive to those many of those folks because it hurts their pride. They're like, I don't need to do that. I'm good. I'm a good person. I don't need the gospel like that drug addict needs the gospel. I don't need the gospel like that prostitute that needs the gospel. We need the gospel because it saves us from our pride. It's offensive to our pride. And so the Judaizers were trying to promote the tradition of men that made themselves look good because they compared themselves to others. And so this is their pride, their arrogance, like, oh, I give my alms and I, everybody look at me, I'm giving now, you see, proof how good I am. Everybody look at me, I'm praying, proof how good I am. Everybody look at me, look at how big my Bible is. I like big Bibles and I cannot lie. Pride. The gospel, the true gospel, is offensive to our pride. Okay, next one. The true gospel, and you need to embrace this. You need to embrace this and let go of your pride. Be humble. Let it go. Maybe you don't even know how prideful you are. Let God show you. Pray a prayer that nobody ever wants to pray. Humble me, Lord. The prayer that's not the top of the list. The top of the list is, Lord, give me patience. That's on the top of the list. But the second one is, humble me, Lord. All right, the next one. The gospel offends our wisdom. We're smart. We have wisdom. People in this world, you know, they have the ability to know things. Don't you know how smart I am? Let me just tell you something. What you're doing right here is wrong. And let me tell you why. The gospel offends our wisdom. We want to speak into everybody else's life. Our society is that way, isn't it? Everybody's in everybody else's business. And just say, Lord, dumb. I don't know. I don't know exactly what needs to be done. That's a hard thing to say, isn't it? It's like, and it's not completely true in the sense that, you know, we're just dummies, but we need God's understanding. We need God to teach us. Look at what it does. The gospel offends our wisdom. It saves us by something many consider foolish. God becoming a man and dying a humiliating, disgraceful death on our behalf. You know, one of the hardest, there are different religions that are out there, and one of the hardest steps for people to cross over, it's the chicken bone stuck in the throat of, it's hard for them to swallow, it's in the big old chicken bone on the side of their neck, they just can't swallow this idea in the religion of Islam, is that God became a man. It's really hard for them to accept that. That's one of the tenets of the Christian faith, is that God became man. Because it's foolish. Other people, they think, there are other religions, other cults, other groups that are out there, like, no, God wouldn't become a man. You know, it's too dirty, it's too earthly. No, they try to distort all of those things. In fact, they'll say, no, God didn't become a man. A little God became man. No, God became man. It is hard to understand this truth, that God is infinite. He is all-powerful, and yet he allowed himself to be contained. Here's what the image you got to think about, in a little baby. God was God as a baby Jesus. No, but that's what's hard for people to accept, because it is foolishness. God's ways are way beyond our ways, and we have to trust that God's wisdom is above our own understanding. Now here's the truth. Look at that graphic there. What does it say? There are two wisdoms, human wisdom and God's wisdom. The question you got to ask yourself is, which is influencing you today? We already know that in the world at large, they are leaning on their own human wisdom, political wisdom, societal wisdom, academia type wisdom, science type wisdom, and yet God's wisdom, what he likes to do is he likes to get the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. That's his style. That's his way. And that's why he came as a baby. He came as a man. He died a humiliating death. There are people that are real strong physically, and when they look at the passion, they're mad that Jesus would allow these men, these Romans, to beat him. He should do something about it. He's strong. He's being humiliated. They're making fun of him. There are people that it's hard for them to accept that God allowed that to happen to him. But this is the wisdom of God, brothers and sisters. Don't let the gospel, don't shy away from the truth that he did die a humiliating death. It was disgraceful. In fact, the scripture, according to the scripture, says, cursed be everyone who is hung on a tree. He became a curse. He became a curse for us. So it was humiliating. He became a man, able to experience death, and it was all so he could do it on our behalf. That's the gospel. And then the last one, the third reason why the gospel was perverted in Galatians was the gospel offends our knowledge. It tells us to believe something which goes against scientific knowledge and personal experience. That a dead man, Jesus Christ, rose from the dead in a glorious new body, that would never die again. That he would never die again. And what's the picture? What's that picture of? See that? Who's that that's putting his finger in his? Oh, yeah. See, even disciples, even people that are followers of Jesus can doubt. Doubt this, because it goes against scientific fact. To this day, Hollywood, the movies that are coming out, they're constantly, constantly wrestling with the idea, what comes after death? We don't have to wrestle with that. If you trust in the gospel of Jesus Christ, you can see how futile and how nonsensical it is, these questions that they ask themselves of what the meaning of life is and what's on the other side of life. We don't know. We don't need to know that because we already know. It's Jesus. Jesus is our Savior. We get to go into heaven. It's going to be amazing. There's not going to be any tear there. The King of Kings is there. The disciples, those who have gone before us, are going to be there. There's going to be a reunion. There's going to be food. There's going to be even animals. There's going to be horses, right? There's going to be sheep. There's going to be a new kingdom. You read into some of the futuristic things that are going to be happening as we're in heaven. We're going to judge. You ready? He's got so much confidence in you, sis. You're going to judge angels. That's what he said. We're going to join him in judging angels. Do you think you have the ability right now to judge angels? No. Are you kidding me? Michael, you're wrong. No, we don't have that ability, but he's going to give us the ability, this amazing gift in the future to where, wow, we're going to have authority to judge angels. These are all the things that God's going to give us, and I'm looking forward. The death that we experience in this world, this is important because we've had some deaths in our congregation and in our families, and it's just a comma. It's just a pause. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be amazing. And so there's nothing to fear because we receive the gospel and it doesn't offend our knowledge. You know, we're not offended that he's trying to tell us what's on the other side, that he's got to live for, that he lived forever. No, because he's going to give us a gift and we're going to live forever with him. It's going to be amazing. So that's the gospel. The gospel offends. Go back to the first one, Jim. Just a quick review. Here's a distorted gospel. It offends our pride. It tells us you need a savior. You can't save yourself. The next one, it offends our wisdom. The foolishness of God becoming a man and dying a humiliating death, being disgraced on our behalf, it doesn't offend us. Next one, the last one. It offends our knowledge that we can believe that regardless of the scientific impossibilities of Jesus dying and resurrecting and fulfilling the scriptures, it doesn't offend us because God is God. Let me leave you one last thing. You can go ahead and go to some other slide, but let me just leave you with this one last thing. God will do all these things with the gospel. He opens us up as we trust in him, place our faith in him, and get in this new life. Now we've been born again. It's a new life. We're in this new chapter. We have a new purpose, a new future. And then he confirms his gospel the whole time, step by step. Because there are times that we doubt. There are times that we struggle in our faith. He'll bring us back to the gospel to remind us this is the gospel. And then he'll do something to remind us, hey, let me just remind you, I am more powerful than science, and he'll do something that just blows our mind. It's a miracle. Maybe it's a healing, right? Maybe it's a provision out of the blue, something weird that just happens. I'll just share with you one thing. I was struggling with my faith. I was struggling with a time in my life that I was really hurting. I had made some mistakes in my life, and I was really feeling ashamed and bogged down. And I went for a walk, and I went to the school, and I sat down, and I was just crying, weeping. And the pressure was so tough. And, have you guys ever went through that? That kind of thing? You guys ever felt through that? So I was struggling, so I lay down. I'm outside on this bench. And just crying. So I'm like, God, I know I can get through this only if you're with me, though. I got to know you're with me, God. I'm just struggling. You know how weak I am. You know how weak and just, I know I don't deserve any of it. I don't deserve any goodness, any future, any help. I'm crying there. There's tears are just running down my eyes as I'm looking at the sky. And then God makes two shooting stars cross right in the sky. I'm looking up at the stars and whoa, whoa. I sat up, I was like, forget this. God is on my side. Get out of here, science. The odds of that happening at that point in my life, amazing. And God just does, he likes to do those type of things. He likes to show off. Another thing, God was giving me, I wanted to do something like open a church and have be part of a ministry. I believe anything that we do has to have a stamp of God's word. Stamp of approval. So this was years ago, and I knew in the future this was gonna play a big part. So I was thinking, what would be a good name for a church, Lord, if I were to ever plant a church? We're talking 2008, 2009, or a ministry, and then worship has always been a part of my ministry, and what I'm always trying to convey to people that come to throughout the years, throughout the ages, since I've been a teenager, because it worked for me, is we don't worship on Sunday mornings. We worship every day. Unfortunately, that's a problem we have in the church today, is people only worship on Sundays, and then the rest of the week, they act like the devil. I like, amen, Lord, help me, Jesus. You know, it's like, so, throughout the years, I've been thinking, you know, Lord, help me to help people to worship not only here on Sundays, but even throughout the week. Because worship is every day. In fact, it's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So, God likes to show off, and he showed me in his word. Psalms, son, your favorite book, go to Psalms chapter 24. Verse 7. Open up to me, you ancient gates. Open up to me, you ancient doors. And let the King of glory in. And that's why we get open gate. We are open to the King of glory 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Just look at it. Look it up in your Bible. If you need to be reminded. Every day. So, God will show us, he shows off, he will show us that he is, his gospel is beyond our wisdom, our pride, and our knowledge. Amen? All right, let's bow our heads for a few moments, and let's let God just seal this in our hearts. Just say a quick prayer for yourself right now, as we are responsible for his word in us. We read a whole chapter. We read four verses from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We heard some comments. And now the question is, what are you going to do about it? We heard some, we know what the gospel is. We know what the gospel isn't. We know why people were attracted to it and people were willing to distort it, because there's something inside of all of us. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you help me. You help us to take in the pure stuff, the stuff that isn't distorted, counterfeited, it's not stepped on. It's the true stuff of your gospel message, the good news. Lord, we pray that it would have this powerful effect in us. Let it do something beautiful in us. Let it do your awesome work in us. Let it save. Help us to convey it to others around us. Let it encourage. Let our faith grow in you. In Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you and praise you that you get all the glory and honor in your name. Amen and amen. All right. Keep on playing. What we're going to do is we're going to transition. We're going to continue worshiping with our giving to the Lord. But I want to just remind you, if you want to, we have some envelopes that our youngsters have, these future preachers, pastors, or business owners, or husbands, helping out with our ushering. And go ahead and stand, guys. And what they have in their hands are some baskets with some envelopes. If you can put, you can put some information on there about your visit here. Maybe a comment you want to ask. Let me know. Let us know how God spoke to you. You can do that as well. You can also do that on our Facebook. Let us know. We need to hear some feedback on what God has been teaching you. And so go ahead and let's go ahead and, Lord, bless this offering for your kingdom. Let it accomplish spreading the gospel throughout the world. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I long to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. Let's stand together. Okay. Here's a challenge. Next week, if somebody wants to come back, come up here and repeat what the gospel is. You memorized it. You can do that next week. Hit me up. I'm just throwing it out there if you want to do that. Maybe we can get one person to do it. You tell me. I want you to know that God has prepared you with the gospel. You got it. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4. You got it. Now you can share it with somebody. You hear that? And it has the ability. It might be offensive, a little bit offensive, but it has the ability to save and to lift up and to grow. You ready? Are you ready to share that? Lord, in the name of Jesus, anoint each and every person here, ambassadors of the gospel of Jesus Christ. As you open doors, help them to walk through those doors in communicating the gospel to those around them. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You are dismissed. One last correction. Pete's service, the funeral service, is going to be September 24th. Friday, September 24th. So the cleaning date is Thursday, September 23rd, not this Thursday. All right?